Last night, Erica Rhodes was, I guess, recovering from her weekend gig back home, feeling in her place. And she, as she does often, writes funny tweets. And one that caught my eye was she wrote on Twitter, "My friends really want me to make it, so I'll stop hanging out on at their houses." And I replied, "That's funny, but most of the comedians I know or talk to think you are an example of making it. I would hate to be someone looking to make it a life in comedy and get the notion that Erica Rhodes hasn't made it. You represent what so many aspire to be." And now that is absolutely true. If you know, like, there are several levels of the comedy ladder of success. And I've had them all on this program. But unless you're really at that top level, the Robert Kleins, the Doug Stanhopes, the Steve Burns, I don't know, I'm just grasping at swords here, Tommy Chong, I'm just thinking of the people who have actually made big money in comedy that I've had on the show. Unless you're one of those, you're at the point where Erica Rhodes represents to you, if you know her, and many of them do know her, know about her through me, because I've been singing her praises for the last 2 years or so here. If you know of her, you look at her and say, wow, that is somebody who's making it. First of all, she really loves comedy. That's apparent, because when I had her on the program and kind of talked about that, this life in comedy, she really enjoys making people laugh. And she's doing that for a living. And she's become, over time, put in the dues and worked it and written really great material and performs it perfectly, because she's also got acting skills and all that kind of stuff. She acquired mastery. And I think that's what most comedians, if you're thinking with a artistic mindset, that's what you want to be. You want to be master of your craft, and you want to be able to make a living. So that's what I put out there. Once again, I'll read my reply to what I said. That's funny, but most comedians I know or talk to think you are the example of making it in quotes. I would hate to be someone looking to make a life in comedy and get the notion that Erica Rhodes hasn't made it yet, because to me, that's what making it is all about. And then it said, "You represent what so many aspire to be." And she replied, I'll have to find her reply here. I guess making it doesn't include dollars then. Now, dollar sign. You and I have people we admire in show business, and we like to assume, or we tend to assume, that if they've been on television, you've seen their face on television, they're financially set for life. These are, you know, anybody we see on The Box, we tend to think they're rich. If they're famous, they're rich. And she is famous, at least with the, and more famous than I even knew, because my brother told me everybody he talked to in his North Carolina circle knew of her and were fans of her. So we don't know what they make. Yeah, and for somebody like her, I mean, it's not like it's public record. Like Dave Chappelle, you could look up his worth. Joe Rogan, you could look up his worth. And there's no reason you should, and don't bother. But I'm just saying, so when she says, well, making it doesn't always include dollars then, and that's absolutely true to some extent. Now, I think you have to be able, this is where, why it was a concern to me and why I felt it was a important conversation to have. I understood it was a joke, and it was a funny joke that she started out with. People want her to make it so that she gets off their couch. I get that. But so many of the comedians that have been on here are focused on making it. And I'm like, well, define making it. What does it mean to make it in comedy? Well, I think yesterday I touched on this. If you can pay your bills and in a comfortable fashion, now this is my definition, not necessarily has to be everybody's definition of making it, what it means to make it. If you pay your bills in a comfortable fashion and to create the art that you want to make without anybody else's foot on your neck, boot on your neck, making you, you know, do things the way they want you to do it. You are a free agent and in charge of your own destiny, artistic wise. You love what you're doing for the most part. There's parts of it, you will always have parts of it you don't love, but you love what you're doing. You love performing and you're getting paid enough to support yourself. That can be looked at as making it. The problem with so many people on the bottom, and we'll get to this, is that they are not making it in terms of being able to be self-sustainable. They can't pay their rent. They work for $5, sometimes nothing, at open mics all the time. And they look at, what does it mean to make it? Well, what does it mean to make it? Now, somebody like Erica is a headliner. She gets flown to cities to perform where she is the main attraction and other people are opening up for her. That, to me, if that's not making it, then we should all give up. I understand her frustration with the pay stuff, and we've had this conversation offline and online for a couple of years now. I don't know how seriously she takes me. I'm just another guy who is a fan to her, but we have had these conversations, and particularly difficult for women, coming back to the whole financial aspect of it. Why is it more? Well, first of all, there is still the old school women are not funny belief in a lot of men who run the industry. It's sad, but it's still true in 2023. But beyond that, there is a big difference between female performers and male performers in expenses. What do I mean by that? Well, first of all, in every part of, so, you know, flying around the country, there are all these kinds of expense in travel, in accommodations, in ground travel, and all that stuff in between. And as a single woman traveling alone, it really, you can't cut corners on stuff. Where guys, you know, Sam Talent can get off a plane and just take a cab and not, you know, not worry too much. But women in particular also have an expense that almost no male comic, there's a few people who spend money on wardrobe. You don't see very few guys out there in the comedy world are spending money on wardrobe. But almost all the women are. You see women performing comedy, they're well put together. Erica is included in that. All of them. You could name one, you know, for the most part. Now, I will say I did see one open for Doug Stanhope last year who was in a ripped up, dirty T-shirt. But she was going through a depression at the time. And she's a person who's... But for the most part, I'll just say women have an expense in wardrobe and to wear nice clothes and hair and makeup and all that kind of stuff, which costs money that men don't have. So getting paid less than men and having more expenses than men, it's a struggle. So even if you see somebody like her, wow, she's making, she's a star. She's a headliner. She goes everywhere. Everybody knows her. You see her on television. She must be rich. Don't assume that. And living in LA, for the most part, is super expensive. All that stuff comes into play. So you know the frustration with it. A guy named Ethan Nicole, he said, I remember when I hit the level most other comic artists or people in animation saw me as someone who made it. I distinctly didn't feel like I had yet. I decided around that time that I would consider making it a daily thing. At the end of the day, I provided, and I didn't give up. I made it. Good for him. Good. And I like that attitude. But he's probably paying his bill. I don't know how he, still not clear on how he defines making it. But then I replied, I was bemoaning. Now, this is a story I've told on the podcast 1,000 times. And, you know, if you've heard it, you've heard it. But I tried to condense it. I said, I was bemoaning my lack of success with a billionaire who stopped me and told me how I was living his dream. It's too long a story for Twitter, but it was a life-changing perspective shift I wish every artist who wants more from life could hear. And Erica replied, it just favors TikTok now. And then I said, comedy is a cruel business to the people who create the art. I don't claim to know how to address that. I know that respect from your peers doesn't pay your bills. Sorry you aren't being compensated for the mastery and you have and the joy you bring to so many people. But I think it's important because we have friends out there. They think they're making it. They think they've been encouraged to keep doing what they're doing because there's evidence that they're making it, because they're getting more stage time. But they're 5 and 10 years into it, and they still can't pay their rent. They're still living off the charity of others. That's not making it. Because this goes back to the affirmations crap I was talking about for the last 3 weeks. And yes, it has a lot to do with my friend Will, who I'm very concerned about, who is being led astray or led to believe he's doing things constructive for his career, when in fact, he's not getting any closer to how any right-minded person would consider making it, at the very least, being able to pay your bills. Getting trophies for best open micer that night is great, but it won't put food on the table. And as long as you have to live off of somebody else's charity, I don't think you can consider it making it. No matter what level, I don't care if you've headlined, if you're living, if somebody else is putting food in your mouth, clothes on your back, driving you to your gigs because you can't afford an Uber or you don't have your own car or any of that stuff, you're not making it. And you're not getting any closer to making it by following that path. You can lead on formation. Just keep going. Don't quit. Never give up. That's all it's about. Never giving up. That might be true. If you keep doing it, for maybe at some point it will dawn on you that there is another way if you don't give up. It's important to have a strategy, though, and a plan. And this is part of the frustration in comedy. It's not that cruel in music. Comedy is the cruelest art form there is in terms of getting not only the respect you deserve for the time you put in and the value you bring to people's lives, the joy you bring to people's lives cannot be discounted, and it needs to be compensated fairly. And yes, the TikTok generation is making content creators and comedians feel like they have to do that. But that almost across the board doesn't pay. If you're a content creator, influencer, Instagram creator, or TikTok creator, or Facebook Reels and YouTube Reels, if you want to make a living from that, you really have to do it every waking moment of every day, and you're not going to ever, odds are very strong that you're not ever going to make the big money. You're not going to be Mr. Beast. You're going to be somebody who, like me, gets a check from YouTube. The biggest check I ever got from YouTube was almost $800, $770 or something like that. Biggest check I ever got from YouTube. And that's doing really well. So you're not going to be, unless you have a lot of different revenue streams, Patreon and all this kind of stuff coming in, you're not going to be able to make a living from that. It's good to have. But people get fooled into believing they need to be there because that's what how their audiences find them. That's why the audiences come to the show. Maybe to a certain extent, but you don't need to be there every day. And unless you plan on monetizing it as your main source of income, you don't need to be on there every day constantly doing it. I think a lot of there's a lot of mythology around, and because Steve Byrne was at an airport last week, and he was doing jokes with his phone for Instagram and Twitter and TikTok, and he put out the sentiment that he didn't want to do it, but he felt like he had to do it because his audience needs new, fresh new content every day. I think you have to give your audience a little more credit for loyalty and not being so needy. We don't need fresh content from the people we admire every day. I would, you know, Steve Byrne, Erica Rhodes, Doug Stanhope, you name it. The comedians that I am a fan of, I'll go see them if they're reasonably local. Whether they're putting out TikTok content, daily content or not. So this is that. But I do think, and Craig came back to me, our friend Craig Johnson, who I love dearly. He said, it was a joke, Dad. And I said, you know what? Right from the beginning, I said it was a joke, and it was a funny joke. I get it. I get why it was a funny joke. But my concern and where I feel like I have to address this is because so many people do look up to Erica. So many people that got turned on to her by me continually saying how great she was and found out about her, comedians I'm talking about, who are in the life and now look up to her as the model for making it. And if she says she's not making it, what does that do to their mindset, their you know, their whole attitude towards what making it really means? Here's somebody, and I hate to overuse the word, but one of the heroes, somebody who you look up to and you say, man, if I could only get to be where Erica Rhodes is right now, I'd feel like my life in comedy was solid. And then she says something like she doesn't feel like she's making it. Her friends want her to make it so she can get off their couch. That blows a hole in not only your strategy, your confidence, but your belief and attitudes about what making it really is. So that was my only reason for addressing that. It wasn't to try to argue with Erica, because I don't think she took it that way. I think she genuinely, and I don't know this for a fact, but I think she genuinely appreciated the comments and where I was coming from. But I have had conversation with her on and off air over the last 2 years about this idea of, you know, making it pay in comedy. And so last night, and I don't know how many people who are not in the business care about this or know about this or any of it, there was a writer's strike for the major studios, the Writers West, I believe it is the union. I don't know. They went on strike because the heads of these studios are making $1 billion. They picked out in the argument and why, in their reasoning why they decided to strike, is that the heads of the studios, and they picked out, you know, a handful and added their salaries together, making close to $1 billion. Meanwhile, the people who create the content, the writers who make the shows work, can't pay their rent. I don't know that's true. I mean, I don't know how much is exaggerated. And because when you hear these things on social media, you want to just immediately, your instinct is to say, wow, they can't pay their rent. You're writing for a major television show, you can't pay your rent. So statistically, it doesn't really matter if they really truly can't pay their rent or if that's an exaggeration. They're not being compensated fairly compared to the guys who just sit at a desk and yes, and green light and red light things and get paid $100 million a year. The disparity is there. But so Erica continued, writers are on strike because the writers don't make it for more money. Meanwhile, she's there writing content on Twitter for free. There is an equivalency here with the studio owners and the writers who make nothing, and the comedy club owners and comedy club chain owners making bank, while the comedians sometimes make zero. Now, Erica said $20. I'm here, right? Most comedians, she said, most writers are striking for more money. Meanwhile, most comedians are fine with making $20 at a local bar. And I did not write this because I did not want to become a totally annoying prick about this stuff. But the truth is, a lot of the comedians I know, $20 would mark a significant payday because they're used to getting nothing or $5 or a drink. Yeah, here's your pay, a drink. Yeah, I know it doesn't put gas in your car, food on the table, any of that stuff, and you are the reason people came to my club tonight. Here's $5. Or here's nothing. And or here's a thank you and a handshake, if you're lucky. $20, most sad to fucking say, it's heartbreaking to say. Most of the comedians who've been on this program who are not household names, the working class comedians, most of them work too often for less than $20. And for most of them, a $20 payday would be, hey, I'm onto something here. Now all I have to do is increase, you know, I'm on my way to making it. Look, I got paid $20. Now, if somebody wants to argue that I'm wrong there, I'm all ears. I mean, all the shit that I'm babbling, obviously, is the opinion of a guy who's not in that world right now. I am in the entertainment business. I am gigging, at least until Sunday, where I might get murdered or might murder somebody else or might go to jail or any of that kind of stuff. But for the time being, I am in show business to a certain extent and far less talented than most of the comedians who've been on this program and bring a lot less value to people's lives than some of the comedians that I've had on this program and make a lot more, like hundreds of times more. And it's not fair. Why it is and how we address that and how we get comedians fairly compensated. Listen, I don't want to say that horse has left the stable. How you get it back in the stable, the genie's out of the bottle. The comedians agree. And here's the problem with both writers and comedians is the club owners or the studio owners know how many people want that job. And they don't care about quality. They really don't care about quality. All they care about is that you will keep people coming. They can continue to produce shows with a body in that spot. Even if it's shitty content, and you know that this is true from the shows that you see and the movies and television shows and all that stuff that you see, the writing has gone downhill. It really has. I mean, the quality of writing. Now, there are some quality writers out there, and I'm not disparaging every writer, but if studio executives know that you're just filling the seat for 1,000 people who want your job and can do it maybe not quite as well, but to a satisfactory standard that product gets put out, they don't fucking care. And the same with the comedy club owners. Comedy store. I'm sorry, comedy store. I didn't mean to single you out, but Mitzi started this shit, to be honest with you, not paying people. And we've had the comedy strike in over this 35 years ago now. But the idea that comedy club owners understand that if a comedian isn't happy with what they're getting paid, I'll get somebody else. There are now, if you're in the comedy business and you don't like your job, we have 10,000 people ready to replace you in a minute. I can make a phone call and have 10,000 people apply for your job. So it's a difficult thing. How do you manage that economics of supply and demand when the supply of people who call themselves comedians, it's just a matter of calling you, putting that, I'm a comedian. That's all you got to say. Well, have you worked? Well, I've been getting nothing for doing open mic nights for the last 5 years. I'm a comedian. And I'm there the minute somebody who's getting paid isn't happy with their pay, and I'll work for less. And if they know that, what is their incentive for paying you more? To be friendly to you? Capitalism is not about making friends. It's about making money for the investors.
I love my dog. I love you. I love having the dog be the best friend of my mind.